Hey guys, happy Wednesday. How's things going in the land of lockdown? Some of you I know are slowly coming out of it. Some of you aren't. South Africa, yay, you can buy booze. I'm okay. I've had my cousin and her husband stay with me for the last month, which has been really great. It's been a nice break to have some energy and people in the house. But getting down to what I want to talk about today, we will see where this video goes. It's something that I've been wanting to talk about for a while. One of the main reasons that I started this whole vlog thing. Here we go. Death. The shittest thing about life and the grief that is the bitch that goes with it. So 2 years ago today, I received the worst news imaginable, that my dad had died. It didn't take long for the emotion to start. I suppose this is the first time that I'm really talking about it openly like this. I don't talk easily, so I suppose this is in a way a fake talk, because there's no one really here. It's a feeling and a moment that unless you've experienced it, you will never ever know what that feels like. And the shit thing is that you will experience it at least once in your life. It's not like, I don't know, a car accident or a divorce or, you know, other things that life throws at you that you may never experience, which is great. Death is one of those things that everyone will experience. Yeah, I mean, I don't really know where to go with this. So I work on the yacht. So I was in Italy at the time and my dad is in South Africa. So it was completely out of the blue, massive shock. Didn't really know what was happening. Obviously got on the next plane home and everything kind of was a blur. I have my brother, who is my dad's child as well. He's in Austria, so he flew out as well, but only a couple of weeks after I was there or got home. So there was a lot to do. What I really just wanted to chat about is it's something that's individual for everybody. It's something that the textbooks say can take up to 3 or 4 years to get over. You'll never get over it. There's all the different stages that you might identify when you look back, but there's no real order of things. I went through a very dark phase of just not wanting to do anything. I picked up about 12 kilos. I was drinking a lot. I was smoking again. Life was just not fun. I was very angry all the time, you know, looking at other people's parents or just other people in the street that just look really unhealthy, and hating the fact that my dad died and they still around. I mean, terrible thoughts, terrible, because he was healthy and fit and strong. And yeah, you try and reason with yourself. Obviously, once everything was done in South Africa, I had to come back to work, and it just felt like it was all over. You know, there was no time for me to really process things and grieve properly, because I had to just kind of get back into it. And because you're not there, I wasn't with my mom, I wasn't at the place where we strewed ashes, I was totally disconnected. So it was really, really difficult for me. It still is difficult for me. I mean, I think about times Chris and I have bought a house, we've done loads of renovations, my dad is super handy, he's an electrician by trade, so I was thinking of all the things that he could help me with the house in the UK, and, you know, things that he hasn't or never got to see of my life, which is, for me, really sad. 10 days ago, it was his birthday, which was on the 16th of May. For me, it was a really sad time because, like, 10 days later, he was dead. I mean, just, like, really weird. And that was the last time that I spoke to him as well. It was on his birthday. I thank God for my brother, because we've obviously lost our dad together. And he's just got such a great outlook, which I try when I'm feeling really low and sad, think about, but it's difficult, you know. He's quite matter of fact, he's quite spiritual. Death is a part of life, which it is, so he's very accepting of life and what it throws at you. And he just tries to remind me to think of all the really good times. And something that I'm trying to implement is not to associate my dad with a sad memory. Or a sad feeling, which is really, really difficult now, obviously, because what he was saying is that eventually that's all you're going to associate that person with is that sad feeling. Because obviously, the more you think and do and feel things, the more your brain and your body gets used to that. So, you don't want the habit to be thinking of the person and then having that sad feeling. So whenever I think of my dad, I do try and think of happy memories, to try and associate that thought with a happy memory. When it was his birthday last week, I spoke to my brother and I was obviously really upset, and feeling quite emotional. And he was just saying, you know, it's dad's birthday today, so we should be celebrating because it's not a sad day. Because it was his birthday, it's the day he was born. The day that we should be sad about, if we're going to be sad, obviously, is like today, because that's the day that he died. So it's really interesting, different outlooks. And I would just really encourage you, if you are going through a death, which I think during this time of the world at the moment, I think a lot of people are experiencing it, loss. Try and think of the good times, like if that person was sitting next to you, what would they be saying? For those of you that know my dad, he's super dry and sarcastic and quite humorous. And so that then made me laugh and smile when I thought about what he would be saying if he was sitting next to me right now. I was looking online, just a little bit of prep for the video, and they said there's 5 stages of grief. Which, like I said earlier, you could experience in the exact same order, you could not experience them. 5 stages of grief are denial, anger, bargaining, depression, and acceptance. And then I did a little bit of further delving, and there was an article about 7 stages of grief, which I actually quite preferred. They've got denial, and then they've added shock into that as well, which I agree with. I don't know about the denial part. I suppose that's like not accepting the news, but the shock I definitely agree with, because whether you've been expecting or not, it's news that you'll ever get in your life. And then they've added pain and guilt. Pain for me, for sure, would be physical and emotional, I suppose. Yeah, I mean, that's quite a good one. Guilt, I think that'll run through forever, because you will always look back and go, oh, I should have called that one last time. Or like, one thing that I really wanted to do is take my dad to the Panama Canal for one of his birthdays, and it's one of those things, just, oh, okay, we'll do it next year. So I've got a lot of guilt about that as well, because I just really wish I had done that. Then anger, so that's their third one, which again is something that I think you carry through, it comes and goes. I felt that I was very angry. Not so much anymore, but I was very angry at every unhealthy looking person that walked past me. And like, even I felt, and which is also, I suppose, guilt comes into play, because I felt even angry at friends' or family's dads who were like old and unhealthy. Like, I don't know how to explain it, but it's terrible. It's a terrible thought to have. It's awful. But I suppose, yeah, just like, why did mine go and yours didn't? When yours, especially, or when you are clearly unhealthy, horribly overweight, smoking, or whatever it is. I mean, it's horrible thoughts to have, because everyone's life is important. I suppose you just try and, I don't know, channel your emotions somewhere. Bargaining is another one that they've put on there. I don't really know. I suppose that's like what I've just spoken about now a little bit, really. Why you, or why not you, why him, and trying to figure things out. For me, it's a big figuring out process. They've added, so depression, which is a given, but they've also added reflection and loneliness to that So depression, reflection, loneliness. But I quite like the reflection and the loneliness part, because obviously I don't like like feeling that way, but I like the description, because whether they go together or not, there's definitely a point where you think about your own life, where you think about relationships, where you think about your parents. So I think about my mom a lot. I thought about my gran, because she passed away 3 years ago. It's strange because she had a really good innings and I was there as well. I got to say goodbye, and it was, everything was really peaceful about it. And she's such a strong believer in God and Jesus, and her faith is incredibly strong. I knew where she was going. And then it's a reflection, because then I think of how my mom must have felt, because although I lost my gran, my mom lost her mom. You know, the way I've now lost my dad. It's like, I think maybe it's programmed into you as a grandchild, like, you know, grandparents die. I don't know. But then I thought about her as well, and my mom, and how she felt when she died. My husband and his family, they lost their mom 4 years ago. Again, talking about how you just, I mean, I just never grasped what they went through. Obviously, I was there for them. I tried to empathize and sympathize and be there, but went through it now myself. I had no idea. So yeah, there is a lot of reflection that goes on. And then the loneliness part, which also comes and goes, because although you have people around you, I have my husband at the time, I had friends around me, you do feel really, really lonely. Even though my husband knew what I was, you just feel like you're alone. No one understands. Life's never going to be the same again. It's not, but you obviously have to deal with the new normal, like we all trying to deal with now with the whole corona situation. There's, life will never be the same, but you need to learn how to deal with it. So there is that loneliness for sure, where you just feel like no one gets you, no one understands, and you're just alone in your grief and your thoughts and your memories. That was quite pertinent. The other two that they've added in, which I really like, because the initial five stages are just like crap. It's like that gives you no, there's light at the end of the tunnel. So they've added in the upward turn, which is nice, because there is one. I feel like I'm slowly getting to that upward turn now, because the next one is reconstruction and working through, and then the final one is acceptance. So they still keep acceptance, but I think those two that they've added, the upward turn and then reconstruction and working through before the acceptance, I think is so important, because I feel that those two stages, whenever they happen, they can also come and go, very, very important before the acceptance. But I personally, where I'm at right now, I don't think I will ever, 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 ever accept the fact that my dad's gone. I still talk about him in the present tense. Somebody about a year ago brought that to my attention, that I talk about him in the present tense, and then I had a moment of like, oh, is that wrong? Like, because then you think, oh, but should I talk? And I thought, no, you know, I'm gonna stick talking to about him in the present tense, because he's still alive in me and my memories. And I think the acceptance part comes right at the end, and I'm probably differently for different people, so I don't think I'll ever accept the fact that he's gone, but I think it's more of a learning to live with it. So anyway, coming back to the upward turn. So I feel like I'm slowly maybe approaching that upward turn, which feels good. But then the guilt comes in again, because I feel like if I'm like carrying on with life, being happy and not being sad, then I'm like not missing him as much, or not thinking about him as much, or I don't know if that makes sense. Like you feel like if you're carrying on with life, you're just carrying on like everything's normal, but it's not normal, but you need to carry on. It's difficult to explain. I think people that have gone through it maybe know what I'm talking about. You feel guilty for carrying on is maybe the easiest little way I can explain it. I just think what he would want for me, and he would want me to be happy and thriving and healthy, and the way I try and find comfort in that. There is an upward turn. It might take a year, it might take 5 years, it might take 10 years. I just want you to know that there is light at the end of the tunnel. A year ago I thought, okay, I'm gonna post this video, and it was just too raw and way too sore. It still almost is now when I talk like this, which I don't do at all. The emotions come to the surface. But for me, this is a bit of therapy and a bit of upward turning, and then reconstruction and working through. So the upward turn is in sight, and then you start reconstructing your life, I suppose, and learning to live your new normal without them and working through. I feel this is a part of me working through. I've got back on the health train, been about a good year now. I've lost weight, I'm feeling healthy, I'm feeling fit, I'm feeling quite settled and happy within myself. Obviously you go through ups and downs all the time, especially during this period, because like I say, a week ago it was his birthday, today is his anniversary, 27th. So then you always have a bit of a wobble, and then there's moments where you think about, you know, like Chris and my wedding anniversary, I think about that, I think about my birthdays, I think about when I sit outside and have a gin and tonic or a white wine spritzer, I always think of him. But I'm really trying to make those moments happy thoughts and not always sad. Like, yeah, try and take my brother's advice with that. And then finally, what I did speak about initially was the acceptance, which might come in terms of, okay, cool, I accept that now. Or it might come as, I accept the fact that I'm never going to accept it. I feel that's where I'm at. And then just learning to live that new life, I suppose. But if you're feeling, if you've gone through a loss recently or 5 years ago or 10 years ago, and you want to reach out and have a chat, please do. I do understand those moments that you feel like life's just not worth carrying on or making that effort. And just try and think of that person. And just think what they would want for you. And as cliched as that sounds, depends where you are at, I suppose, in your process. I find that that's very slowly starting to help me now, that he wouldn't want me to be in a horrible space. So yeah, I find a little bit of comfort in that. And then the guilt comes back in because I'm moving on and I shouldn't be moving on. As soon as I'm feeling emotional and sad, then that means I loved him more. It's ridiculous what we think and feel and go through. So yeah, that's a little bit of my journey the last 2 years. I've had amazing support with my family and my friends and my husband and my God, because I do feel that it is faith and prayer and obviously love and support that is getting me through. God is a big thing for me, huge comfort, huge affirmations when I read my Bible and I go to church. Now we're doing webinar church and I find a massive comfort in that. Today marks 2 years. I love him dearly and I miss him very, very, very much. Life was meant for living and he definitely lived his. So I want to do the same. Like I say, please feel free to reach out, or if anyone else is going through anything at the moment, please feel free to share this video and get them to reach out. I don't mind at all. Wishing you guys a good week ahead. Stay safe. Yeah, have a good one. Bye.
If I could get another chance, another walk, another dance with him, I'd play a song that would never, ever end. How I'd love, love, love to dance with my Father again. When I and my mother would disagree.